About 3 weeks ago, I released a video called I Was Wrong, My Thoughts on Warmonger, where I confessed to being wrong about the developer's intentions with the Warmonger character, and I expressed my disappointment that the Knights were, once again, being portrayed as the villainous faction. Now, several people replied to me both rationally and fairly, pointing out that the Order of Horkos was made up of multiple factions. It just happened to be led by Knights. But still, there was one comment that argued the reason the Knights are the villains in this world is because they were the villains in history, and he pointed to, obviously, the Crusades. The argument was clear, but his history, in my opinion, was far off, and it was more clear than ever to me that most people simply do not understand the Crusades. Pop culture and media have really misrepresented the Crusades and what they were really about. After I finished the Guan Yu series, I knew that I would do a similar series on the Crusades, but after seeing this comment and hearing a few others along the way, I think that we need to start in a different way. Before I start walking us through the history of the Crusades and what really happened, we need to debunk a few myths and answer a few questions. Now, I've studied the Crusades for a long time, and I like to think that I know the basics well enough, but if there's anyone I know that's a better authority than me that I can get easy access to, it's my own brother. Since I'm on vacation this week, I decided to hang out with my brother and let him join me in debunking some of these major myths on the Crusades. My brother has taken a class in college on the Crusade history, has a major in history, and specializes in European war history and culture. He also, like me, is a descendant of the Knights of Malta. So, ready to get started? We're going to start by debunking the major myths of the Crusade, and then we'll answer a few questions you asked in my last video. So the first question that I think we want to talk about and debunk is this one. It's one that we hear a whole lot, and it's one that I really want to talk about. The Crusaders were the instigators of the violence, attacking without provocation and seeking the genocide of the Islamic states.
Muslims didn't go up from Jerusalem and march up to Europe to attack Christendom. No, the Christians marched down to Jerusalem to attack the Muslims.
So I guess the big question here, Will, and I'd love your input on it, is were the Crusaders the instigators? Did they start it all up, or what was the instigation for the Crusades?
Well, to put it simply, the Crusades were called by Pope Urban II, and they weren't just called because, hey, that's a nice chunk of land that we find holy, I want you to get out. It was more complicated than that. You see, understand, the Islamic Empire, and then eventually empires, because they broke off into several different sultanates and caliphates, they were exploded out of Arabia after the death of Muhammad, and they swept across Persia, completely knocking it out, even going past the Indus River Valley. They quickly went across North Africa and into the Iberian Peninsula, and so they were moving very quickly. They were slowed, however, by the Byzantine Empire as they pushed into Anatolia, and several different Islamic empires invaded and took territory with varying degrees of success. However, in the 11th century, a new Islamic empire, the Seljuk Turks, because the Turks had just recently converted to Islam, viewed the Byzantine Empire as the new stomping ground. And so they, like several other Islamic empires before them, were going to try their hand at knocking out the Byzantines. And outside of a town called Manzikert, they decisively defeated the Byzantine army and even captured the Byzantine emperor. Because of this, the Seljuks took control of most of the Byzantine heartland in Anatolia, depriving them of most of their grain resources and area that had been traditionally held by Byzantine or Greek hands for centuries. Because of this, the new emperor that was ascended to the throne, Alexius, he realized that he was going to have a hard time taking back this territory without outside help, particularly since he doesn't just have to worry about Islamic incursions, he also has to worry about Bulgars and other Goths to the west. So he calls for help from Pope Urban II, sending him a letter saying, hey, could you send me some help? And from that, Pope Urban basically goes to a Clermont in France, and he basically calls forth the idea of a crusade.
Okay, so what you're saying is it all started kind of within, the way I've always understood it, is it started with an Islamic expansion, and that expansion took them up into the Byzantine Empire, where the Byzantine Empire was being sacked, they were being defeated, and they called for help from Pope Urban II, who then called for the crusade. It was not just a, idea of, because I've always heard this, you always hear about, especially on stuff like the Young Turks and stuff like that, you hear, the Crusaders, they just went in and they attacked the Holy Lands, the Muslims there weren't doing anything, no one was doing anything wrong, but they just decide to attack because they feel like it.
Muslims didn't go up from Jerusalem and march up to Europe to attack Christendom. No, the Christians marched down to Jerusalem to attack the Muslims.
I think it's important to understand that in this game, I'm not going to point fingers at anyone for being the instigators in this, but I do think it's important to understand where the violence began. And it did not just begin with the Crusaders being war-hungry lunatics.
Well, yeah, the people that would become Crusaders, they did fight wars back in Western Europe, but really the Holy Land was not a thought in their mind. It was not the concept of, yeah, I think I should go out there. Keep in mind, the Holy Land is a very long way, particularly in an age where the fastest way to travel is either by horse or by sail. And so getting over there required a lot of effort. And so it's without a greater call or a reason to go, they would not have just said, this seems like a good target to go after.
Okay, awesome. So the next question that I want to touch on is a question that I think is a little misunderstood. Maybe you can give some clarity. It is, the Muslims were the true owners of the Holy Lands and the Crusaders had no rights to claim them. Now, before you answer this, I want to bring up something about the right to claim them. We often talk about, in fact, this person in the comment that we're doing this all because of was arguing that wars for secular purposes like claiming land are fine. They're one thing. That's how war goes. It's the idea of a holy war, a war in the name of a god, that's the problem. So first of all, I don't think it would be a problem if the Crusaders were just coming in to take land, because the Muslims have been doing that for a long time. Other armies have done that since forever. The idea of claiming land, I don't think, is a real problem. That's secular warfare, and that's the way things went back then. But I think the question we need to answer here is, who really did have rights to the Holy Land?
Well, that's a good question, but that goes into less of a historical topic and more of a philosophical question, because if you look at the conquest and say, of all men throughout history, like, did the Turks have a right to take over Anatolia? Did Caesar have a right to take Gaul? Did Alexander the Great have the right to take Persia? It's more of a right by conquest, and that's how they viewed it. Now, keep in mind, if you want to talk about claims to the Holy Land, there have been claims to that section since before Islam, since before Christianity, and since Judaism was just becoming a thing. The thing I like to joke about with the Middle East is I say, it was once a great peaceful place, and then people moved there. And that just threw everything out the window. The only time you actually truly find any real peace within the Middle East is when there's like one singular empire that is controlling the larger area. And even at the time before the Crusaders were going over there, it was fragmented between multiple different Islamic empires. But before the Islam exploded out in the 7th century, it was considered the Holy Land and, most of North Africa, was controlled by the Byzantine Empire, Eastern Rome. And so, it could be argued that the Crusaders had every right because they were assisting the previous owners to try and take it back. Now, it didn't work out exactly as Pope Urban Alexius had planned, but that was the original casus belli, or just cause to fight.
Awesome. Okay, so myth number three that I really want to touch on, and this is one I hear a lot of, and it's something that was brought up in the comment we're addressing. The Crusaders were bigoted against the Jews and Muslims and called the Crusades to force Christianity onto them, killing them if they did not comply. So the idea of forced conversions. Now, if there's one thing that I do know, it's if you really look back into history, if you look back at this point in time, you'd be hard-pressed to find any group or culture that wasn't bigoted against the other. The Muslims thought they were bigoted against the Christians and Jews. The Jews thought that they were better than the Christians and Muslims. The Christians thought that they were better than the Muslims. Everyone thought that they were better than everyone else. If I understand my history correctly, that's just the way it was, right? People were bigoted against each other because they had a superiority complex, which leads to these conquests and such. But I think the big question here is, did they force Christian? Was there forced conversion in the Crusades on the Christian side? Is that something that happened?
Really? No. The forced conversion really was more of an Islamic idea, and that was typically when it, and it isn't exclusively located with the Crusades, it's the idea of when an Islamic army takes over a territory, particularly in a jihad, they give the people that survive an option. So your choices are A, die. Now, a lot of people didn't like that for obvious reasons. B, convert, which means you gain all the political rights that associate with being in an Islamic empire. You're a Muslim, you're considered as equal to every other Muslim, unless, you know, there's a noble around. Then, of course, if you say you don't want to give up your faith, be that Judaism or Christianity, you can become a legal status known as a demi, basically meaning you pay a special tax, and then you're left alone.
And the tax is called the jizya, if I remember.
Yes, it is called the jizya, and how much the jizya would take would vary from Islamic empire. Now, in the Crusaders, keep in mind, they didn't send priests. I mean, priests did go, but they weren't the main combatants. And so the Crusaders' mentality was, we are here to take over an area. Now, they would offer the idea of converting to Christianity, but typically when an Islamic commander is offering conversion, it's after they've already won. Crusaders, on the other hand, if they were in a stalemate with an Islamic general, they might go, hey, you know, you're pretty good at this. What do you say, you know? What if you change sides? However, this was common throughout warfare at the time period. If they found a commander that had something they wanted or that was rather impressive, they would offer them to try and say, hey, why don't you come and change sides? But when the Crusaders were victorious, they didn't really say, hey, if you don't convert, I'm going to kill you. They didn't do that. And it also varies greatly depending on the commander. Some commanders, when they took over, Crusader commanders, they would just go, all right, you're all dead now. I tried to give you a chance to surrender. You didn't take it. I'm going to kill you. Some would just go, all right, I'm in control. You're all peasants, right? All right, just go back and do whatever it is you do. Just pay your taxes on a normal day. That's all.
And to follow up on that, just so that we're moving on, I do think what you said is good, and I also agree. I also think that it says a lot. So in the question of the Christian, I think the big myth is that the Crusades were called for the purpose of forced conversion, and I think we can both agree that was not the case. It was not about forced conversions. Was that the main goal of the Crusades? Briefly, do you think that the goal of the Crusades was forced conversion? Were the Christians trying to force Christianity on other people?
No one of high intellect was trying to do such a thing. No one would do such a thing unless, I mean, if a Muslim came forward or a Jew came forward and said, hey, I'd like to, you know, convert to Christianity, they'd be happy about it. Just as a Muslim would be happy to hear a Crusader come over here and like to convert. They'd be ecstatic about that too. But the thing is, they didn't go out, their main mission was not, we're going to convert. Their mission was, we're going to retake this area. Because one reason why the Holy Land was of particular interest was that there were rumors that pilgrims, even before Alexios called for help, the pilgrims that were headed to the holy places, like the Holy Sepulchre, were being attacked. And so, because of that, the Crusaders sort of attributed that to all of the Islamic states in the area. When really, it wasn't just Christian pilgrims that were attacked, it was Muslims and Jewish pilgrims as well that were also being attacked. But of course, Muslim pilgrims typically didn't send their pleas for help to Western Europe. So that doesn't get reported. Now, as far as the bigotry thing, there is something I want to establish. Because, as you did say, you're going to have a hard time finding anybody who wasn't bigoted at this time. The Byzantine Alexicomenos, when describing the Western Christians, she refers them as more of a barbarous and vulgar race. The Crusaders' view of everybody else is pretty much, well, we're superior. And the Islamic view is, well, we're superior. In fact, during the siege of Antioch, a Turkish leader actually described the people that they had conquered as effeminate. And I believe the direct quote is, do you think that we came this far in order to marvel at your nobility? Great and small, whom you might call to mind should claim this land, which we with courage snatch from an effeminate people.
It sounds to me like they were pretty bigoted themselves. But yep, so that's awesome. All that's cool, but let's go ahead and move on to the next one. Okay, awesome. Moving on to myth number 4, and that is, this isn't a big one, but it's one that I do hear a lot, so let's address it. The Crusaders underestimated the Muslim strength and lost the Holy Land in the end, thus making the Crusades a giant waste of time and energy. Briefly, how would you respond to that?
Which Crusader? Because the real question, because it depends on one, which Crusader leader we're talking about, which Crusade we're talking about, whether we're talking about a actually called Crusader or Crusader state attacking or defending. Because it depends on a lot of leader. A lot of the newer Crusaders, they didn't, there was a little bit of a gap, because they were very zealous, like, yeah, we're going to help out. And a lot of the veterans were like, no, hold on there, chief. Let me tell you what's actually going to happen. All right, bring it in. Because here's a fun fact. The Byzantines were probably one of the few that actually had the least bit of underestimation in time. They had actually classified each state around them as how effective their warriors were. They attributed the Saracens and the Persians as being the craftiest and, you know, most gifted intellectually. They considered the Franks, i.e. the Crusaders, as being the most ferocious fighters. And there were several cases of Crusaders underestimating, or in some cases overestimating, the Islamic states. And there's vice versa, where you have some Crusaders, like the Turks, in their initial fight against the actual First Crusade, greatly underestimated the Crusaders' effectiveness in fighting, particularly with heavy cavalry. And later Islamic empires, like the one led under Salah ad-Din, had a better idea of what he was dealing with. So once, it's really the X factor. Both were an unknown entity to each other, but once they started to get a better understanding of each other, then their tactics and fighting styles adapted.
And we'll answer the question of whether or not the Crusades were a waste of time probably in the end of our series, just because that's a broader question, and that goes into a question of justification. Were the Crusades justified? Did they have a higher motive or goal? That's something we may want to discuss after we've walked through the Crusades in their entirety. So that, I think that's a good answer, though. I don't think it's fair to say that one side underestimated the other at any one point in time. They both had their underestimation points and both had their overestimation points. And other times, they just knew exactly what they were dealing with.
Oh, yeah. It's just like, it goes to the idea of who's leading the army at the time. Because it depends on, like, who's the more competent commander and who plans the best.
Okay, man. So, really excited about this next one because it's one that I really... really don't agree with it. It's a great one, and it goes back a while. Okay, so number 5, knights at the time were just entitled and pious bigots who used their own wealth and upper class position to bully their own populace into fighting their wars for them, and that's what the peasant crusades were. Okay, so I remember back when we were kids, we watched the show Deadliest Warrior, and they did an episode where knights fought pirates, and the whole idea was that they were testing the whole idea of black powder weapons versus armor, but one of the pirate experts argued that knights were just privileged individuals who would never fight their own battles if they didn't have to. They'd send in their peasants or underclass or foot soldiers to go fight for them rather than actually go fight themselves. So before we go into what the peasant crusades were, what do you think about that? What do you think about the knights being these entitled...
Well, one, it depends on the knight, because, you know, knights are human. You may have one that's a little more into the douchebaggery than the other one, where you might have one that's more fulfills the exemplars of what is chivalrous, or what is chivalrous at the time. It's really hard to say. Now, the idea that they forced peasants to fight for them, there's a grain of truth to it, but it's typically, if you ask a knight, hey, want to go send the peasants in the battle? There it goes, like, no, that's the last resort. That's a rear guard action we're doing if peasants are fighting. Because keep in mind, this is feudalism. Peasants and serfs are tied to the land. So if those peasants all die, no one can work the land. And if no one can work the land, that agricultural economy of feudalism can't work. So peasants were typically, in medieval warfare, generally only used as a last resort, and even then, it wasn't looked upon highly, because even if you're the invading army, if you see you're fighting peasants, you're gonna go, well, dang it, who's gonna work the new land that we just conquered?
Right, that's a good point. Okay, so, lastly, and I know you have notes on this, but... Oh, I do. Okay, the Peasant Crusade. Briefly, what really was the Peasant Crusade?
Now, if you talk to a uneducated Marxist, they might tell you, oh, well, the peasants were forced to go on this crusade. No, absolutely not. In fact, you gotta understand, the Crusades as a holy war were viewed not just as a war action, but also as a pilgrimage, because they wanted to get to the Holy Sepulchre of Jerusalem. That was sort of like their big goal, because pilgrimages at the time were a very big deal. In fact, people would collect badges going to various different holy sites as sort of like a, you know, saying like, look how great I am and how pious I am. And piety was stretched from all the way to the king, all the way down to the peasant. So when Pope Urban II called forth for the First Crusade, a lot of people got really excited about it. Not just knights and lords, but peasants too. In fact, there was one guy who is largely responsible for the peasant crusade, known as Peter the Hermit, or Peter the Cowl, and he basically went around recruit all over France and parts of what would become Belgium and the Netherlands, saying, come on, we gotta go do this crusade. And then he just made a beeline for the Holy Land, because Peter, prior, had tried to go to the Holy Land, but was rebuked and couldn't go, but now he was going to come with his peasant army, and they were going to go in, they were going to throw open the doors of Jerusalem, they were going to go and have a good time. However, both Alexius, Pope Urban II, and anybody that had a military mind said, dear Lord Peter, don't do that, to which Peter said, no, I'm going to go do it. So then eventually he shows up with this giant, massive horde of peasants that very few of them have any fighting experience whatsoever. A few knights tagged along too, because, you know, it seemed like a good idea at the time. And they camped outside of Constantinople, and Alexios and every other Byzantine official was going, what? where are the warriors, I promise? This is a map. And Peter's like, yeah, we're going to go do it. We're going to go do it. And Alexios says, listen, I appreciate the enthusiasm. Believe me, I do. But you aren't going to do over well with just these peasants. Please don't. And he's just like, well, no, I'm going to go. Like, we're going to do this. And the problem is, with all those many people, you have a lot of mouths to feed. And how did they feed themselves? By ransacking Byzantine territory. So the peasant crusade was not looked kindly upon by the Byzantines, and they said, all right, fine, go over into Turkey, have fun. And so they ferried them over across the strait, and they went in ransacking as they went, because once again, they had to feed themselves, and they really didn't know how else to, because, you know, they're peasants, they don't have any money to buy food.
Right.
And so as they went through, the Turks found them, slaughtered them. Those that they didn't slaughter, they had them convert to Islam and then enslave them, which other Islamic countries were going, whoa, 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 no, you can't enslave a fellow Muslim. What are you doing? If they convert, you can't do that. Which the Turks said, I do what I want.
It seems like a common thing with the Turks. We do what we want.
With the Seljuk Turks in particular, Osman, when he comes around, he's going to be a little classier about the situation. And so Peter actually escapes, and Alexios actually saves his bacon, and he goes, what'd I tell you? I told you this would happen, and this is exactly what happened. You should have waited for the main force. And to quote Peter, and I'm paraphrasing here, oh, it's not my fault.
So we could argue that maybe the Peasant Crusade was the first real example of a, not a church-funded, but church-inspired protest.
Well, a church, it's a little awkward because parts of the Peasants' Crusade would go off and kill Jews in Germany, to which the Catholic Church said, what? No, wait, where did you get that idea? You actually have we have a documented account of a bishop defending Jews in a cathedral, holding off German peasants, going, back, you animals, back.
I think that we may need to stop there. I know that this is a big subject for us, but we gotta keep moving. So, all right, next one.
Okay, so this next one, and this is the last myth that we'll debunk before we get to y'all's questions. And this is a big one, but the Muslims had been a prosperous and advanced nation, far beyond what Europe was at that time, until the Crusaders showed up and destroyed their culture and livelihood. In fact, had the Crusaders never happened, the Middle East would not have become so violent today. So, you touched on this earlier where you said that you like to believe that the Middle East was a peaceful land until people showed up. You know, the whole idea is once people started populating the Middle East, things got pretty bad. But this whole idea, I've heard so many places that Muslims were, especially at this point in time, highly advanced, scientific, medically ingenious individuals, whereas the Europeans at this time were living in crap, living in their own feces, talking like idiots, bad teeth, poor health, believing in black magic over science.
That tolerance and curiosity ushered in a golden age of Islamic learning centered in Baghdad. The Abbasids oversaw an effervescence of culture unlike anything that had been seen since Hellenistic times. Most historians now agree that the Crusades didn't bring Europe out of the Middle Ages by offering it contact with the superior intellectual accomplishments of the Islamic world.
Is there any truth to the fact that the Islamic states at this time were so highly advanced? And if that's true, did the Crusaders really ruin their whole livelihood and culture with the Crusades? I think that that is an excellent question. What do you think?
Well, I'm glad you asked that. And there is actually a bit of truth to this. The Islamic empires did have a lot of scientific and mathematical knowledge. However, to say that Europe was, you know, completely ignorant is false, because you have to remember the Byzantines are still running around, and they're one of the most enlightened areas in the entire world at this point. Keep in mind, when the Islamic Empire first exploded out of Arabia, they knocked out Persia, and so they had all of the great works of Persia that they were able to bring into their fold, and they were able to study, keep, and preserve. And then they took over a large part of what was the Roman world, which they were able to then translate into Arabic, keep, and preserve. And so, Alay were able to build off of a lot of the great works of the Greeks and the Romans and the Persians. And the Byzantines, of course, they still had all of that. Then you look at Western Europe. And the thing is, Western Europe, it is not, nature had not been kind. It's because you have to keep in mind, Western Rome collapsed. And then you had several different kingdoms that would pop up trying to sort of reclaim the ashes. And you would have periods of enlightenment, like the Holy Roman Empire established under Charlemagne. But of course that would break up due to Frankish succession laws and wouldn't be reestablished till much later. And all over this, you also had to keep in mind the Viking Age is going on. Then the Islamic Empire starts to expand into Western Europe through Iberia. And so there's basically in a perpetual state of constant warfare, and they were never able to truly recover from the collapse of Rome up until the point where the Crusades are just finally starting to get off on their feet. And to say that there wasn't any great works going on in Western Europe is false, because you had several monks and church members that were actually keeping track and actually keeping and preserving a lot of the great works of the past. But the problem is, the language everything was written in was Latin, and Latin had ceased to be the common language of Western Europe. It was the language of the academic, but the thing is, if you're a regular Frenchman or Englishman, if you want to read anything, you're going to have to learn another language. Whereas in the Islamic Empire, eventually other languages would start to pop up, but the Islamic Empire spread very quickly, bringing Arabic as a language with it along. So, to read Arabic so you could read the Quran, you could read the other great works that have already been translated. But another interesting factoid about this is, those great works didn't go anywhere because of the Crusades. When the Crusaders got there, it's not like they said,
yes, we will be banning anything that seems civilized.
No, they didn't do that. So, when the Crusaders came, the Islamic countries still had all of their great works. When the Crusaders of states eventually died out, the Islamic states still had all of these great works. And to say that they were the root cause of all the fightings that was going on in the area is false. If you look, even during the times of the Crusader states, the Islamic empires are still fighting against the Byzantines, they're still fighting against the Armenians, the Georgians, and fighting against each other. The Turks are fighting the Persians are fighting the Egyptians and the Turks, and vice versa. They're actually, during the reign of one of the Baldwin kings and the kingdom of Jerusalem, an Islamic town actually requested aid from the kingdom of Jerusalem against another Islamic Persian force. And so you actually see during the time of the kingdom of Jerusalem, Crusaders and some Muslim forces actually working together and actually benefiting from it. And so I think a lot of this is just a large popular culture misconception.
Okay, guys, those are all the myths, but you guys had a few questions that you wanted to ask. Keep in mind that there are some questions we're not going to answer here just because we'll probably talk more about them in the actual Crusader videos when we talk about each Crusade in detail. But I did want to answer a few here because some of them are pretty good. So the first one that I actually got a few questions about this. Who were the Templar Knights? You hear a lot about the Knights Templar, especially if you play Assassin's Creed. Who are the Templar Knights?
Well, you can probably answer this better than me.
Well, The Templar Knights were one of the many crusading orders founded during the Crusades. The original order was founded following the First Crusade, because keep in mind, a lot of the Crusaders, once they had conquered the Holy Land and they had visited the holy sites, they're like, all right, my pilgrimage is done, I'm going back home. However, they realized that, hey, we need a force here to help out at all times, and so they decided to form what is known as the Templar Knightly Order, or originally it was called something along the lines of the poor knights of the Templar, something along those lines. And basically, the original members basically took a vow of poverty along with several other vows, and their goal was to basically guard the pilgrims that were visiting the Holy Land. However, as time progressed, some of the vows changed, and they began to become some of the best shock troops that the Crusader forces could offer. They were elite trained soldiers, and they didn't have to pay fealty to any one particular lord because they worked for their own order. Eventually, though, the Templars, after the Holy Land fell back into Islamic hands, they would go back and start working around in Western Europe, ironically, in a lot of cases, as bankers. However, this led to their downfall as they suddenly started loaning to the King of France, which is a terrible idea. And eventually, instead of paying back the Templar Knights for all of what they owed, the King of France just said, no, you're heretics and I'm going to have you burned.
Okay, so the Templar Knights were actually probably a well-known and respected knight order. We've got several questions asking to talk about Salah ad-Din, Richard I, King Baldwin, and those are all very important figures throughout the Crusades, but we're probably not going to talk a whole lot about them right here. We'll discuss them once we actually get to the Crusade videos that they were a part of. We'll talk more about Richard I and Salah ad-Din definitely in the third Crusade video. Now, one other question that I got, it's a little funny, did the warmonger armor style exist during the Crusades? I'll answer that one. No, it really didn't. The kind of armor that warmonger is wearing in For Honor is more akin to late Middle Ages, and the Crusades were much early mid-Middle Ages, so you wouldn't see that level of armor. The Crusaders wish they had that kind of armor, but their armor wouldn't be that advanced. In fact, the armor that the Crusaders had in the earlier parts of the Crusades, they weren't bad by any means, but they were a lot more chainmail oriented than heavy plate mail oriented. Whereas the warmongers appears to be very, very heavy plate mail oriented. Okay, so got a few more and then we will call it. One person questioned, have we looked at the Crusades from a Western narrative, or have we also looked at the Islamic narrative? And here's the thing that I want to say about that. There's always going to be a bias. You're always going to, if you ever research a war or conflict, you're always going to see conflict between the two sides. You're always going to see different accounts because different people rewrite the history books the way they want to. But Will, because you took a class on the Crusade, I'll let you answer this one briefly. Did you also look at Islamic narratives and sources when researching the Crusades or not?
Yes, we looked at, there are three sources you have to look at when looking at the Crusades. You have to look at it from the Western European perspective, the Crusader perspective. You have to look at it from the Islamic perspective, and then you also have to look at it from the Byzantine perspective. There are three different unique perspectives that are going on at this time, and they are all, of course, biased towards each other. Of course, everyone writes the stories like, no, we were right in the right, they're in the wrong. And if you look at it from the Islamic perspective, particularly for those that lived in the Holy Land, they were confused. Because, keep in mind, the Holy Land had not been on the frontier of the Islamic Empire for several centuries at this point, so it had become somewhat stable. However, if you looked at the Islamic frontier in Iberia and in Anatolia, things were much more tumultuous. But suddenly the war front was brought there, and so for a lot of people that were just living in there going, oh, where'd this come from? They didn't realize how large conflicts were raging across the world. And so then it suddenly came to their front door.
Right, and I think that that's important to keep in mind. In today's day and age, you know about every conflict going around the world very quickly, but at that point in time, the people in the Holy Land probably had no idea what was going on beyond their borders, or at least didn't have a good idea of it. Another question we got asked was, were the Crusades justified? We're going to talk about that when we finish the Crusade videos, only because that's a heavy thing to unpack.
Well, that's a philosophical and theological question as well.
Yeah, so we will get to that, but not right now. Okay, so another question that we got asked was, what extent and effect were exotic goods brought back into Europe from the Crusades? What kind of extent did that have? From merchants in Crusader states to smaller towns being established in Europe, the commenter was curious to know about all the cultural exchange of goods and ideas it brought about and how it contributed to the end of feudalism. So how did taking exotic goods from the Middle East, from the Islamic states, and trading them through Europe bring an end to feudalism? I don't think that it ended feudalism, did it?
Well, in a word, no. It certainly didn't help feudalism. But the thing is, what really was the nail in the coffin for feudalism was, ironically, the Black Death. Because with so many peasants dying in some towns, and up to 90%, like Firenze or Florence in Italy, what the labor that was left, they're just like, listen, if you want me to work, you're going to have to, you know, give me a little bit more money. And so the serfs demanded more rights, and slowly you start to see some countries and counties start to get rid of serfdom. However, feudalism, with the idea of serfs, truly wouldn't go extinct until Russia got rid of it in the 19th century. And even then, there are some feudal laws that were actually kept on the books, but nobody enforced in Scotland until the end of the 20th century.
So I guess then in that case, what effect did bringing exotic goods back to the European states have? Like, what kind of effect did that have?
Well, you gotta understand, when Western Rome collapsed and then the Islamic caliphate swept across North Africa, Western Europe was cut up from a lot of the trade resources that were found along the Silk Road. And so when the Crusades went back, they started to reconnect and rekindle some of that connection with the Silk Road. Particularly, one Italian city-state, Venice, really got connected into the trade network. And so, because of that, a lot of Italian city-states really started to become very wealthy off of these trade deals. And they had a bit of a monopoly, along with several Islamic empires, of what goods came into the Mediterranean. However, the Silk Road, being an overland route for the most part, started to get a little bit messed up here and there. And so that actually led to some Portuguese and Spanish kingdoms to try and look for alternate routes, which led to the Age of Discovery. And now, could that have happened without the Crusades? Possibly, but the Crusades arguably accelerated it because one thing that the Crusaders found fascinating is once they started to settle in the Holy Land, they started to find all these unique goods and spices and silks that previously they had never seen before.
Which led into the Age of Discovery, which you could argue helped lead to new lands such as the new world being discovered.
Well, another interesting factor about that is my college professor actually argued that a lot of the Crusader city-states, such as Acre, were actually basically prototypes for colonial cities that would pop up in the New World.
I did not know that. It's pretty cool. Okay, so another question we got were we were asked who were the Crusaders, Templars, and Teutonic Knights. We kind of answered who the Crusaders and Templars were. The Teutonic Knights, I wrote this in my comment response, but essentially the Teutonic Knights were an order initially founded with the purpose of protecting Christians on their pilgrimages to the Holy Land, but ended up waging war in the Crusades, and most famously in the Baltic Sea, where they reached the height of their own power. But we'll briefly touch on the Teutonic Crusades later on down the road. We're not going to talk too much about that right now. Another good question, and I wish we had talked more about this in the myths, but we'll touch it briefly here. What would the Crusaders usually gain from the Crusades besides riches and glory? And in a word, piety.
Well, piety is exactly what sort of caused this whole thing. This was a very different time, and Catholicism was a big deal to that of Western Europe. And so, there's five different accounts of Pope Urban II's speech, so there's a little bit of discussion, but what we do know based on his letters to Flanders is that one of the things was that if you died on the Crusade or went on the Crusade, you would automatically gain a seat into heaven. That was believed by the Crusaders at the time. Now, of course, was there territorial gain? Was there booty to be collected? Sure, but that goes with any war that you have, particularly one that's an offensive war. Now, with that in mind, not all Crusaders made out like bandits. Keep in mind, the original purpose was to give a lot of this land over back over to the Byzantines, and most of the land that they took in Anatolia was. It wasn't until they got to Antioch did they start taking stuff really for themselves. And there was actually a debate about that because there was a guy named Boymond who said, I get to have Antioch, and they say, listen, we're tired of you whining. If you promise to behave yourself, and Alexios doesn't send his reinforcements before the city falls, you can keep Antioch.
So, another question that we got asked was, were two-handed swords or long swords used in the Crusades? And I'll answer that. Not in the early Crusades. They wouldn't have that at this point in time. They wouldn't have this for a while. And the reason why is you got to understand armor at the time. We talked about this, but the armor at the time was still not the best. They still use shields. And if you have a shield in one hand, you got to carry a one-handed weapon in the other. As time progressed and armor got better, the need for shields kind of downgraded. You didn't need shields as much when your armor was better. So eventually they started developing two-handed weapons that could be used without the shield. So by that point in time, though, most of the Crusades were over. Maybe during the later Crusades, like the Teutonic Crusades or the Albigensian Crusades, maybe then we started seeing some long swords and pole arms that didn't require shields. But for the first few, no, we really didn't see a lot of those, if any.
If I might add to that. One thing I want to add is also keep in mind, knights particularly were mounted warriors, and so their main thing was having a shield on one side and a lance or a spear on the other. And so they needed one to deflect incoming blows, and the lance, of course, to focus on that. So the big weapon would be the sword on foot and the lance on horseback.
Right, and another question we got asked is, what were the objectives of the Crusade? What was the primary objective? And I think we really answered that one, but just to clarify, the real objective of the first Crusade was to give Byzantine back the lands they lost and to save them from the Muslim expansion that was taking their city. The later Crusades were Crusades to take and maintain and hold the Holy Land. In all of its different forms throughout the ages. And we will talk about each of those in turn. Each Crusade kind of had its own underlying goal behind it, some good, some bad. But we will talk about that. And the last question that we will get to, this is an interesting one, and it probably deserves its own video, but we will briefly answer it here. The question was, in regards to the Crusades, it's common knowledge that the church promised forgiveness from sins to the populace as propaganda to coerce them to join their armies. But did the Islamic side do the same thing or something similar? So, if the Crusades promised forgiveness and salvation for those who fought and died in the Crusades, did the Islamic side promise something similar? And to that, we really need to discuss the difference between what's a Crusade and what's a Jihad.
But to sum it up succinctly, were there any promises like that to those that participated in Jihad? Yes. If you look at the Islamic sources, anytime a jihad is called, it is believed that, you know, if you dying in the effort of jihad is, you know, you go to paradise. That is the belief of the jihadist mindset. And so, anytime a jihad is called, be it offensive or defensive, it is believed that you are basically giving your life to the religion.
And it's also important to note that Muhammad predicted in the Quran that Islam would rise up and take over the world. That Islam would cover the entire world. So any jihad waged is just furthering that prophecy. It's just furthering that belief. So whether the jihad was offensive or defensive, it was always in pursuit of that same goal. We are going to take over the world because our prophet said so. So when you really look at the Crusades versus the jihad, they both had two different messages. Both were holy wars, but both had two different messages. The Crusades were a pilgrimage to the Holy Lands, basically saying, hey, we're going to the Holy Lands, get out of our way and clear out or face divine punishment. You know, we're going to take back this land. Jihad was more along the lines of, our prophet has preordained our victory, submit or be destroyed. So that, but both gave similar promises, salvation for service and death in the war.
Think of a jihad sort of the way Americans would, back in colonial times, would view the concept of manifest destiny. It is our destiny to take this territory, and therefore, it is by divine right we are going to go and take it.
And we're not going to sit here and argue about who's right or wrong in that scenario. That's just the way these two cultures and time periods looked at it. And so I'm not here to say that the jihad mindset was wrong at this time period, and I'm not here to say the crusade mindset was wrong at this time period. But the question is, did the Muslims promise something different or something similar? And the answer is yes, because that's exactly what jihad promises. Dying in service of the jihad, dying and for martyrdom in the name of Allah. You get the exact same promise as what the Crusaders were promised. Salvation and guaranteed passage into heaven. But anyway, guys, that was a lot to unpack. I really, really appreciate you guys doing this for me. Since releasing that last video, we've almost reached 500 subscribers. I'm so excited. I know this was a stupid long video, but I really, really wanted to answer some of these awesome questions and get through some of these myths. My brother will not be with me on most of the other videos going forward, but he will be helping me with information gathering and scripting, so he will be a part of that, even if not directly. Look forward to the next video coming out, where we will talk about the first crusade and what led up to it and why it was fought. I hope you guys have a better understanding now about the crusades. And if there's one thing I want to say finally before we close things out, it is this. We're not here to argue whether the crusades were right or wrong. We will talk about whether or not we felt they were justified, and we will talk about whether or not we feel that they had to happen. But what we are here to do is cut through the myths, cut through the bullcrap. We've heard from the media since a long time ago, probably back since the 80s, that the Crusades were cruel, mean, and the worst period of Christian history. Did the Christians do bad things in the Crusades? We will find, yes, some did. But we're also going to find some of the greatest moments of honor, nobility, and righteousness done by them too. So we're here to talk about the truth, and nothing but the truth, in terms of the Crusades. They're a fascinating part of history, and we hope that you will follow along with us. Thank you guys again. Take care. We will see you in the next video. Will, any last words?
I think the last word I have to do is, when it comes to the Crusades or any historical subject, keep in mind, if you look at it through a 21st century lens, everything is going to look horrible. So you have to look at it not only by the standards of today, but the standards of the time too. And so, bear that in mind.
All right, guys. Thank you guys so much, and we will see you in the next video.